ladies come forward. We have a special for you before Pastor comes. I'm sorry, before the cat. Sorry, guys. Yeah. Not today.
Encouragement today.
Amen.
And I thought, well, as I look back over my life, I never have felt capable. I look back and wondered why God would permit me to be in a place of blessings. He's let me be. You know, didn't plan it. It was just all God leading. You too, right? And you had to. And I thought, Lord, it's good when I think of the day and age in which we live. Amen. Not because I'm pushing 91, but I'm thinking about the history of the church and the Lord's soon return.
Amen.
Just, you know, the world looks at the news through the radio and television, but we as Christians look at it through Scripture.
Amen.
And God's told us these things are going to happen. And I was just thinking about how that when Britain withdrew from the European Union, she may be that leading nation of that old revived Roman Empire that little horn of Daniel 9:27 is going to come out of and sign that treaty with Israel. That covenant, I should say, not treaty. That covenant. And we believe that's before the tribulation starts. And it could be possible that more of those nations are going to form around Great Britain with her, their connections with the old revived Roman Empire. And then I thought about where is all the action taking place today? You know, some of us were in the Pacific. Not too many of us World War II veterans left, but some of us there, some of us in Vietnam. But the whole situation now centers in the over there around the Holy Land. And then I never did think when I was a kid growing up that we'd ever lose friendship with China. I always liked China. Still do. But seems like now there's a division coming up. And we know through scriptures, we look at time, that there's going to be a 200 million man army come over the River Euphrates from the east. And then I think of all the destructive forces that are being put together by North Korea and then over in Iran. Folks, we live today by God's wisdom, because when He calls it, it's going to happen. And I thought that we want to keep right on following Him. And that's what I'd like to kind of call your attention to today. I want to say again, what a joy, because I think of the joy the Lord gave me. I had Les and Susie's wedding and many of your baptisms, and Denise. And Denise, last Friday, 49 years ago, last Friday, was her spiritual birthday.
Amen.
49 years ago. I remember calling in her home, and her mother. And I remember Denise was a, you, were you a junior high age girl about then when you first started coming, Denise?
16.
How much?
16.
And her grandmother, I mean Barwick, Mrs. Barwick, lived in a garden tract.
Yeah.
Boy, what a wonderful Christian lady she was. Mm-hmm. Loved to come to church. Mm-hmm. She always liked to come by and get my hand, the clothes. But think of that. And Dave here comes to the Lord and his son, and I get to baptize them. I baptize some of you. Remember that. And I want to say just thank you for letting me come to be with you, Jack and Jerry, and my good friend Scott and Patty. They pick me up every Sunday and take care of me like they do. I just thank the Lord for them. And then I want to say a word of appreciation to the Anderson City Council, of which Susie's a part. Because I looked last week on the news, and they were having a meeting, and it, up above it said, "In God We Trust."
Amen.
And that's what we need today. To let others know we're not ashamed of our relationship with Christ. God's awful good to us, folks. Awful good to us. Our Father, we just pause with grateful hearts, acknowledging again, as Les and Dave and others who have been praying have, you're so good to us. And Lord, I thank you for the joy of being here and being uplifted in my spirit with the folks. And Lord, we're here just to let you know that we love you, and we'd like for you to encourage us, each one today, through your word. Because, Lord, we want to be good followers of Jesus. And because we know that if you be for us, who can be against us? So, Lord, open our hearts of understanding as well as our minds, that we might be responsive followers of Jesus. In whose name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Open your Bibles to Matthew, if you have them, the fourth chapter. And I was thinking about Peter, talking about following him. Lord, who's some of those that we would look at scripturally? And I thought the best one would be Peter, to follow Jesus. And here in this fourth chapter, verse 12, when Jesus had heard that John was cast into prison, he departed into Galilee. I'm going to have a little swig of this water. My one lung situation bugs me at times. Don't mind me saying that, do you? But so many times, with one lung, you don't get the air. Well, you who've had lung problems know you. It's only one side, and your one side dries up on your bronchial tubes. And so your voice starts getting that way. You use a cough drop or something. So I'm glad you understand.
Yeah.
And you'll put up with me.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, in verse 13, leaving Nazareth, he came and dwelt in Capernaum, which is upon the sea coast, borders of Zebulun and Naphtalim, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet. The land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtalim, by the way of the sea beyond Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. People which sat in darkness saw great light. And to them which sat in the region and shadow of death, light has sprung up. And from that time, Jesus began to preach and to say, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." The Lord's first sermon was repent. That word metanoel means to have a change of mind about my relationship with God, and to realize how I'm hurting him and myself. And true salvation, of course, is brought on by repentance. And that's the first message Peter had on the day of Pentecost. He told the people to repent. Our Lord's appeal in Revelation to the church is repent, you know. Verse 18, and Jesus, walking by the Sea of Galilee, saw two brethren, Simon called Peter, and Andrew his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishers. It's been my joy to be over there at Capernaum, and to walk there past this little area where in Capernaum where they had their boats. And I pictured how Jesus came by and saw Peter and Andrew and James and John there mending their nets, working in their boats. It's just nothing fancy at all, you know. It's just like a fisherman's little area to come in with your boat. And he said unto them, Now notice he's looking for those to help go with him to spread the gospel. He said unto them, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. And they straightway left their nets and followed him. You know, I think it's a marvelous thing. When you look at your time, remember when you came to Jesus, where you were? Review that just a minute. Did somebody say something to you? What brought you to the place? It was a confrontation in your spirit by what God was sharing with you that you needed help. And I think when you look at Peter and Andrew, his brother, they were common fishermen doing work like a carpenter, a farmer, or anybody. They were doing what they would normally do, and God called them to follow him. I was 8 years old when I accepted Jesus, and my mother was saved in a tent revival. And she told me later I was a baby in her arms when she got saved. I had two older sisters and an older brother. But I can remember as a small boy where I was in church, a little church in northern Indiana. And a 19-year-old evangelist, young man starting out in evangelism, was speaking that Sunday. And he says, we have to know more than just about Jesus. We have to invite him into our life. And I'll never forget, as a boy, I went out of my seat in tears, and one of the deacons met me, and he said, Royal, are you coming to receive Jesus? I said, yes, I am. He prayed with me, went through the plan of salvation. I said, yes, I want Jesus in my heart. And I've never forgotten that day. Amen. Sometimes people say, well, I didn't know what I was doing. Well, don't let Satan put doubts in your mind when you accept Christ. Down at the mission the other day, I was talking to some of the men, and one young man that says he wants to go into the ministry, Rudy. And he said, what do I do about these doubts? I said, well, boot Satan. Kick Satan in the britches. I said, Satan causes your doubt. God doesn't cause you to doubt. That's the first thing he did to get Eve to falter. He got her to doubt God's word. Hath God said? See? Well, when you have those doubts, rest your mind in peace on a promise of God's word. What has God said? And come back with Satan. That's what Jesus did, because he had just come out of the wilderness where Satan had confronted him these three times. Jesus said what? It is written. That's the word of God. So if you have doubt, hit Satan with the promises of God's word. Hey, he promised never to leave me nor forsake me. Hey, he's the one that holds me in his hand. When I was in, I feared to go to Bible college because I was only a C student in school. My mom only went to the 8th grade. And my dad only went to the 6th grade. We were in the Depression. Back there, you've heard people talk about Depression. Some of you might. Well, Depression. People today, I'm afraid many of them don't understand what poverty is. As 5 kids learned what it was. You get up from the table when you've eaten all there is to eat, and you're still very hungry. And you put cardboard in your shoes to get through the winter months. One pair a year was all we could have. But you know, Mom would always encourage us kids, just remember, God will provide. God will provide. What a wonderful mother. Think of your grandmother, Denise, or some of you grandmothers. Boy, you don't know the influence you can have on your grandchildren. Yeah. Stay steady. Keep firmed up in the Lord. And I think when many times you think back of where you made that decision or these important decisions, you wanted to follow Jesus. I was thinking of that song that Denise sang today. Thank you, Denise. Yes, I can remember very well. I was speaking at a youth camp in Prescott Pines, Arizona. Back in 1974, the year Dave Honey graduated from high school. But there was a man there that was paralyzed on his right side. And I was in line waiting for the chow line at that noon. I got in, and there was about over 200 high school kids. And we were waiting in line to go into the chow hall. And lo and behold, here came this, and I noticed some of these boys, four or five of them, were really causing some conflicts in line there, and teasing some others. And here came this Carl Hendrickson, was his name. And he came with his right leg dragging in the granite soil, and his arm aside. He went up to those boys. He undoubtedly had observed they needed the Lord. And he reached in his pocket and he pulled out a gospel tract. And he said, "Wonderful God." You see, Carl had been injured by in construction when a timber fell on his head and it paralyzed his right side and his speech. And all he could say, and he learned to say it, "Wonderful God." And he came up to those boys, pulled out a tract, and handed it out to the leader of that group. And he said, "Wonderful God." And that kid took that tract and shoved it back into Carl's chest. Carl was dumbfounded. I watched him. And he started to cry. And took that tract and straightened it out on his shirt. And one more time, this time he said, "Wonderful God." And the kid took it that time. That night, I don't remember what I preached on, but I know all five of those kids came forward and got saved. And I believe it was all from Carl. And the next day I thought, "God, here you are, you're using a man as so-called handicapped, and he's got a burden for souls." And they had told me how he'd pass out tracts. His wife would take him up to the city park a couple afternoons a week, and he couldn't do much, but he'd pass out gospel tracts and always say, "Wonderful God." And I thought, "Lord, here I am. I've got all my faculties, my arms, my legs, and my speech. And I do so little. I know I'm glad I'm a youth pastor and all, but here's Carl. Lord, he's honoring you." And I sat down out in the woods and penned those words. And God had a young lady there that I sang the words to her. The music, she penned them down, and it became a song. "Wonderful God." Here was Carl following Jesus. Following Jesus. Well, it says here in that 14th chapter again, 4th chapter again, in verse 20, "Straightway left they their nets and followed him." Now, think of the ones God chooses. And maybe you haven't realized everything he might do for you and some of the things you look back at doing through you. You know every one of us. I thank God for the musicians, for John, for anything you do as a Christian in following Jesus can bring glory to the Lord. Now watch this. We often quote it. Romans 8:28. And we know that all things, that's good and bad, watch out. All things work together for good to them who love the Lord, to those who are called according to his what?
Purpose.
Every one of us, God has a purpose when he saves us, to be glorified through us. Everyone can't stand up in front and preach like Les and Dave can. But you have a neighbor, you have grandchildren, you have children, you have friends. You can always write a letter. You can always give a gospel tract. I think the greatest joy, one of the greatest joys I have in looking back over life are the times that God brought this one to himself. They were saved and I had no idea what was going to happen with their lives. But look at them. I had a man call me from Alaska a couple years ago. He said, Pastor Blue, he says, I've been up here pastoring for 25 years. You led me to the Lord when you came to Ashland, Oregon and started a church for us up there, the Ashland Bible Church. And he said, you didn't know it, but you said to any of us that felt led to go on into the ministry, we ought to go to Multnomah School of the Bible and get training. He said, I did. And I came up here. And he said, I've been up here ever since. Now, you see, I had no idea that man was saved and going on. And you may not know that child that you gave something to and helped, or that neighbor you helped, or you stopped and helped them with their car, or they needed a hand here, or you worked out in the garden, and the people you helped, you have no idea, friend. Peter and Andrew had no idea what God was going to do with them. They just knew Jesus wanted them to follow him. And that's what he wants with you and me. Because every one of us, in our way, God can use somehow for his glory. And it's whatever talent, whatever occupation, he can use us if we're willing to follow him. Follow me. Just follow Jesus. Don't follow Royal Blue, Dave Honey, Les. Don't follow people per se. You might honor the Lord that they honor and follow the work of the Lord through them.
Amen.
We may let you down, but Jesus will never let you down. Never let us down. And here was Peter and Andrew, and they left. It was Dwight L. Moody who made this statement. He said, you may be too big for God to use, but you can never be too small.
Amen.
Wow. And friends, I learned this as well. I've used this statement on my daily broadcast a number of times in the morning. It's always too soon to quit.
Yeah.
And it's never too late to start.
Amen.
It's always too soon to quit, but it's never too late to start. And that applies to all of us. Every one of us. You say, well, I don't know what I could. I have so many people. I have a lady, she's 95. I have a whole list of those 90 years of old that I pray for. And now my name's in that list. I prayed for them for years and people got to be 90. I have a list in the back of my candle I pray for. And Millie Tolliver's one of them. She sent me a number of poems. She said, well, I just don't know what I can do. She says, I've got my back bothers me. She said, I can't do much, even around the house and stuff. And I said, well, Millie, you've written poems. You've sent me a number of poems. I called her. And I said, you know, you could even write a letter to someone. Don't be afraid to write a note. Next time I talked to her, she said, you know, I didn't realize what joy I could have by just thinking of sending a card or a letter like I've been doing. Thank you for encouraging me. She said, you can send a card or a letter. For years, I've made it a point to send birthday cards to older people and relatives and those in the ministry that I've known. I've had a joy sending over 100 cards a year to different ones just to encourage them in the ministry. You can do that. A birthday card? Oh, yeah, but it's just things you would do to encourage them in that birthday card. The note you might write, see. So little things. So here's Peter, here's Andrew, they're following Jesus. And the question comes, by the way, when Jesus says, follow me, are we willing to follow him? See, that's the will. The will. Now, I learned something in my older years in the ministry that the firstborn, God says, that opens the womb, 80% of the time will be a male. Did you know that? And God counts that one pretty holy to the Lord. Just look ahead a minute to Luke 2:23. So you'll always, because you're going to wonder where that's at. Luke 2:23. Let me share it with you. The angel. It says in verse 23 of Luke 2, as it is written in the law of the Lord, every male that openeth the womb shall be called holy to the Lord. Now, if you take time to get home, go back to Exodus 13, and that's what God told Israel it would be. Now, I didn't do that. Now, I learned that 80-some percent, they say, of those that break the womb are male. And that first one, God says, is really very important to me. Now, Bill Gothard, that some of you went to, said that the firstborn is normally the most submissive to authority. I don't know where Peter and Andrew were, but firstborn or otherwise, but I think Peter was older than Andrew. But anyway, that will of that one has to be submissive to God. I think today, sometimes we're seeing ingratitude from folks who aren't grateful because of what others have done for them. Think of some that are rebelling against this and rebelling against that. And sometimes they say we have to pray more for the millennials, the 18 to 29 year olds, because it seems to be that segment in our society is the most difficult to see them submissive to authority. Did you know that? So I just share that with you. Here was the need of Peter and Andrew willingly submitting to the Lord. And then this thing. They had to be disciplined. They were there with their dad working. I think they were disciplined children. Do you remember how your will was broken as a child? We had a box elder tree out in our front yard. And I had two older sisters and an older brother, and I sure did a lot of teasing of my sisters. But Mom did a lot of sending me out to the box elder tree to get a limb when I needed, you know what. For a while, I'd get a small limb. And then break, she'd send me back and get another one. And I smarted up a little bit when I learned, well, if I get a bigger one, it won't break, so I won't have to go back and get another one. But Mom spanked me often enough, hard enough, and low enough that it was felt enough. And I believe my will was broken as a boy. And I look back, and I honor my mom and dad. My dad was blind in one eye and was very handicapped, but a loving dad. My mom was a hard worker with the five children, and she'd do things to make us get by. But my mom also was a disciplinarian. And we've learned today, as we think of life and the future, that discipline determines your destiny.
Amen. Yep.
And if we're not disciplined, we won't be submissive to the authority God put over us as a child, to those who are over us as growing up years. The Lord intended for Eve to be in submission to Adam. And because he told Adam first, before Eve was around, not to eat of that tree. But she didn't submit to what Adam passed on to her. She submitted to Satan's teachings and whims. And you know, I can't help but think that when you think of your will being submissive, think of the mom and dad that we had to help us to be submissive. Think of the employee to the employer, civil government, teacher over student. So various areas in society, God gives us that realm of authority so that we might learn to be more submissive to Him. And the whole idea is being submissive to Him, to follow Jesus. Follow me. Be submissive to my will, my authority. Now, God uses willing people. In Isaiah 1:19 and 20, He says this, now get this. If you be willing and obedient, you shall eat of the good of the land. But if you refuse and rebel, you shall be devoured with the sword. God said, I'll promise you something that I'll give you if you'll just be willing and you'll be obedient to my authority. You know that's true of us following Jesus. He wants to bless us. But also, don't forget Isaiah 48:17. And some of you men and women probably never realized who got you into that area of electrical, mechanical, carpenter. But listen to this. He says this, thus saith the Lord, thy Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel, I am the one that teaches you to profit. I am the one that leads you in the way that you should go. Amen. Isaiah 48, verse 17. And many times, as I look back, and I can honestly say, it was all God. Oh God, how He had to break me down to be more submissive to His will. Now, I rebelled against God as a teenager. And God had to chasten me. My mom had a unique statement. And when I was in junior high years, I was with wrong kids. And it wasn't drugs. We didn't have drugs. But it was, sorry to tell you, we were taking parts off of cars. The kid that led our group, Rex Bush, spent his life in the Ohio State Penitentiary for murder. He died there. And I'm not sure he ever came to Christ. But I followed the wrong one. And sometimes that's what gets us in trouble. I thought he was a real cool guy. He was older than I was, 5 or 6 years. But he had us junior high kids doing things we got in trouble with. So we have to be careful. We don't follow the wrong leaders, but we have to learn to follow Jesus. Well, as you look back over life, you realize there's only one life. Think of it, folks. It will soon be passed. And only what's done for Christ will last. Isn't that a marvelous thought? Marvelous thought. And then this was this. What are you doing for Jesus? One person has said, neutral you cannot be. Someday your soul will be asking, what will he do with me?
Amen. Amen.
Following Jesus every step of the way.
Amen.
Learning to obey him. Learning to be submissive to him. And folks, doesn't matter what the problem is. When we're following Jesus, Peter and Andrew and those disciples found they could overcome multitude of situations.
Amen.
Let's bow our heads and hearts in prayer. Our Father, we realize that as we look back over life, many times we let you down. And we got our eyes on the wrong person. And we followed the wrong one. Forgive us, Lord. We know you do. Help us to rejoice in the joy you give us of following Jesus every step of the way. And Lord, there may be one or two here that had a little trouble doing that. And today they say, I'd just like to follow Jesus a little closer in my life. I want him to be glorified. And Father, if they're like that, may they commit their life to you today to do that. May this be a time they would say, Lord, from here on, let me be close to you. Let me follow you. Let me be the vessel that you can be glorified in and through. Maybe today with our heads bowed and our eyes closed, you'd say, Pastor Boo, as you slip your hand up, pray for me. I have a special concern that I might be more obedient in following Jesus. Would you pray for me? You slip your hand up and take it down. Yes, 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 yes. Our Father, we're so thankful that you're so gracious to us and you never fail us. You said, we have not because we ask not. I thank you for these that have asked today, and I pray for them that they might have a better willingness and a yieldedness to follow you, to walk close to you, to do what you would have them to do so you can be what you want to be through their lives. Thank you again for this wonderful family here. And should there be one unsaved here today, may they realize that it starts when we trust Jesus as our Savior and Lord, that you save us from sin. And may they invite Christ into their heart if they never have. We thank you, Lord, for what you're going to do in these lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you for putting up with me today.